We have a good crowd. Okay, so we'll get started. Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for joining the IHS today for a very special roundtable discussion entitled Between Neocolonial Collecting and Anticolonial Resistance, the Logic of Afro-Latiné Latin American Archives in the United States. This event was organized in coordination with the Archiving Objects of Knowledge with Latin American Perspective, a conference presented by LLILAS Benson Latin American Studies and Collections, which will take place this week on the 24th and 25th. We have a very distinguished panel joining us today, including Melissa Guy, who is director of the Benson Latin American Collection. She completed her graduate work in Latin American history at the University of Arizona and earned her MSIS at UT Austin here in 2008. Guy was the first Archer M. Huntington Fellow at the Hispanic Division of the Library of Congress, where she worked on the Handbook of Latin American Studies. She served as president of SALALM, the Professional Organization for Latin Americanist Librarians, in 2019. We're also joined by Dr. Daniela Blakemar, professor of art history and history at the University of Southern California, where she also serves as the founding director of the Levin Institute for the Humanities and director of the USC Society of Fellows in the Humanities. Her publications include the books Visible Empire, Botanical Expeditions and Visual Culture in the Hispanic Enlightenment, and Visual Voyages, Images of Latin American Nature from Columbus to Darwin. We're also joined by Dr. Jose Barangan Alvarez, who is curator of the Latin Americana collection at the Bancroft Library at the University of California, Berkeley. In 2013, he defended his dissertation, The Feet of Commerce, Mule Trains and Transportation in 18th Century New Spain, and he returned to his alma mater in 2016 to take on his current role. We're also joined by Neil Safir, Associate Professor in the Department of History at Brown University, where he holds affiliations with the Department of Hispanic Studies, the Institute at Brown for Environment and Society, the Program in Science, Technology, and Society, the Center for Latin American and Caribbean Studies, and the Native American and Indigenous Studies Initiative. He is the author of Measuring the New World, Enlightenment Science in South America, and has also served from 2013 to 2021 as Beatrice and Julio Mario Santo Domingo Director and Librarian of the John Carter Brown Library. And lastly, we're joined by Dr. Daniel Dominguez, Associate Professor of History at Rice University and Director of Undergraduate Studies of Rice's Center for African and African American Studies. Dr. Dominguez is the author of The Atlantic Slave Trade from West Central Africa, 1780 to 1867, and is the current host of the Slave Voyages website. Now I will pass things over to Dr. Canizares, who will serve as the moderator for our event today.
Thanks, Ashley, for the introduction to all these distinguished participants in a roundtable that is informal by nature. Ashley Garcia is a fifth-year graduate student in our department who works on the 19th century utopian socialism in the East Coast. And our graduate assistant in the Institute of Historical Studies. So the purpose of this conversation, informal conversation, is to reflect on the Benson's centennial. We are celebrating the beginning of the collection in 1921. So we are past a year from the original inception of the collection. Although to be fair, we should be celebrating 2034, in that the library was separated from the main library only in as a distinct Latin American collection in 1934. So between 1934, it was part of the general library. It was a collection based on the acquisition of a large Mexican archive of Genaro Garcia. And it took about 13 years to become a separate entity. Eventually became the Benson Collection or the Benson Library to honor one of the main librarians. So the point of this conversation is to partly reflect on the past of this library that has different components to it. It has a Latin American collection, but it also has a Latinx collection or Latine collection. It has all these elements to its past that are fascinating in unto themselves. I mean, the foundation of the collection on two Mexican archives by collectionists, Genaro Garcia one and Garcia Icazbalceta the other, which is the origin of many Hispanic collections in the United States, including the Bancroft, the Huntington, in the Hispanic Society in New York, et cetera, the John Carter Brand Library. And then there is this other dimension, which is the Latin American studies element to it that begins with the Cold War, begins earlier in Texas because it has this connection to borderlands, but it's in the Cold War that Latin American studies really come of age. And so it spreads that way, it grows that way. And finally, the mobilization, political mobilization of Chicano students in the 1960s and 1970s that demanded collections of Latino collections. And the university responded by not creating a separate collection of Latinx documentation or books and archives, but assigning to the Benson that task as well. So in all ways, the Benson, it seems today, kind of anticipated the times in that you have Latin American documents, but also Latinx documents, and they are all both combined. And now it seems to me in 2022, it's very difficult to separate them both, to make a separation between the Hispanic population of the United States that has come from Mexico or from Central America and so on and so forth, from the Latin American component of it. So there is finally the Black Lives Matter aspect to the politics of today that is called attention to what seems to be a lack of attention to the Afro-Latino, Afro-Latin American populations. And so kind of the task for this roundtable is to reflect on this past and reflect on the future. Where are these collections heading? Not only Benson, but other collections that have to do with Latin American and Latinx populations. So we have four distinguished panelists. We'll begin with the director of the Benson, Melissa Guy, and then we'll turn to Jose Adrian Barragans as the curator of Latin Americana at the Bancroft. Then we'll move to Daniela Blackmar, then to Daniel Dominguez and Afro-Latino collecting, and finally Neil Safir. And then we'll open up this to a discussion to the wider audience. So Melissa.
Sure. Thank you, Jorge, for that nice introduction. And I want to say thank you to Courtney and Ashley, everyone who keeps the Institute for Historical Studies going at UT. The Benson has always had a good relationship with the History Department at UT, so we're appreciative of the efforts and the collaboration there. You know, Jorge, you did a pretty good job of articulating for the audience the general trajectory of the history of the Benson collection. So I don't want to, I'm not going to dive into a particular timeline because I'm not sure that's the more interesting piece of the conversation. I think, you know, when I considered the number of questions that you posed as part of the advertisement for the panel and all the different things that could become part of this conversation, for me, it boiled down to the general question of, you know, what does the way we've collected in the past say about what were the realities and the priorities of the folks who preceded us, of course, and what was the world in which they were living? But then, you know, what does that mean? And how do we do things differently now? And how are we thinking about doing things differently in the future? And for us, you know, and you're so right, Jorge, that in terms of delineating a particular mark to celebrate an anniversary, we all know that historical periodization is complex, and there are a number of benchmarks that one could point to. We settled on 1921 because every time we tried to, you know, shift it to a different date, we came back to the question of, well, we're going to have to explain why we didn't start with Garcia, you know, because Garcia was the root. So in the end, we started there, and I think everything else is open for conversation. But for us, the centennial, to be honest, it's less about sort of celebrating the collection, that the Garcia collection itself or the Benson as it is, but it's really about thinking about the second century of the Benson. 100 years is a nice round number, you know, to take stock. And we certainly exist in a world where questions about how we go about caring for and preserving and making accessible cultural heritage production, the thought process around that, I will argue, is much more, I think, complex than it was in 1921 or 1934 or even 1945 when Nettie Lee took the helm of the library. And so mostly I just want to have a conversation with my fellow panelists to think through, you know, that aspect of the trajectory of the history of the Benson. And then at the same time, thinking through what it means for the Benson to occupy this space where, and Jose and Neil, I'd like to hear your take on this, but one of the things that does set the Benson apart, at least in terms of the collections that are also represented on the call, is that we are not, in terms of our current collecting, we are primarily not a colonial collection. In that space, like historically, we are a colonial collection, right? In terms of colonial Latin America, that's what I'm talking about. The majority of our current acquisitions, quite frankly, have to do more with contemporary writers, contemporary historians, contemporary activism. And so our interactions with the creators of the cultural production sort of sits at the center when it was impossible for that to be the case in 1921. That's not me overlooking the long history of the Benson and the role that the Benson played in removing what is Mexican cultural patrimony and housing in it in what is the United States, but it's a reflection of how we look at the scene very differently. We definitely say, one of the phrases that we use at the Benson, and this came from Jose Montelongo, who was a curator for us for quite a while, no somos coleccionistas, that we're not, we don't occupy that space for the sake of it, that the whole point of building these collections is to provide access to them, and then asking ourselves, provide access to whom? And for what purposes? And so I could pose all kinds of questions like that and sort of explain where the current thinking of the Benson is on those matters. But what I'd like to do is sort of, you know, give my fellow panelists a chance to weigh in on their thinking on some of the questions you raised and then dive into the discussion, which I think is the more important piece of this. Thank you.
Thank you, Melissa. Jose.
Thank you, Melissa. This was great. Thank you also to the Institute, to Courtney, who I've missed dearly, and Ashley. I was also one of the graduate students who helped at the IHS in the early years. So it's good to be back at UT. Yeah, I think those are Jorge's questions, but also the questions you posed, Melissa, are I think are super important to look at not only where we're going, but what we're doing. And sometimes one of the things that I've been thinking of, yes, it's how these were acquired, certainly for Bancroft's point, how they were acquired, but also, you know, where and where we want to go. But I'm very limited. As you noted, our collection is heavily colonial. It is because of the nature of H.H. Bancroft's collecting at the time in the early 19th century, and also the nature of collecting now. Purchasing a book now is so expensive. We just had the California Antiquarian Book Fair, and I think I got one item because my budget limits me to get one or two, you know, items that I want to bring into the collection. So I think for us, it's also shifting the process of how do we make these more available. And, you know, one of the great things about Benson is that it has been able to digitize a lot of its material and make it available for others. Whereas Bancroft, certainly in the Latin Americana collection, we have not been able to do that. So I think that your question about who do we make this available for and why are we, you know, why do we keep collecting and who is it for? I think those are really important questions that we have to keep asking ourselves too, as we move forward with this. And as someone who's, you know, who's benefited from both working at Benson and at Bancroft now, it's a real privilege to be able to talk about this, because I think these are the, you know, two of the leading institutions that really anchor how we look at Latin America from, you know, its inception, or it's you know, that horrible period of conquest to the present and where we want to go with it in the future. For me, for us at Bancroft, I think I have to work with the curator of Western Americana for anything that has to do with Latinos in the US. And it's something we're currently working, you know, right now, where we're looking at communities and the community, the Latino community here in the Bay Area that has gone unrepresented or underrepresented in our collections. And I think that's sort of our main focus. It's we're still want to do, you know, the core. We still collect to our strengths. Just to add a sort of glimmer, the Bancroft, when we say Latin Americana, we mean Mexico and Central America. So I think that's also a big issue, because H.H. Bancroft, again, was focused primarily in what he called the Pacific states. And so it's the Pacific states that form his understanding of really collecting for California. That's what he was trying to do, and place California into this greater context. For us, it's more of a continue to do that, but also, but I do look at what's happening. You know, one of your questions, Jorge, was on Chile and its current issues, you know, of you know, this being a world recognized place for the study of seismology. You know, a lot of Chileans came to Mexico to look at how Mexicans had dealt with the earthquakes. So I think that's one of the things where I might not be able to collect on Chile, but when you said that, I was like, well, but I can certainly get the Mexican stuff that sort of fits into that. So I do think of all these questions. I think it's really important to have these conversations, to continue these conversations. We have them at Salam. We meet once a year to have these conversations. That's our librarian association for Latin American librarians. And it's a great place. You know, I encourage those of you who are in the audience who are not part of it to think about joining Salam, because it is a really great space for us to continue to, you know, have these conversations that we have been having certainly since I can go back into their histories and look at their histories, which the Benson has. So I think it's a really important conversation to have. So I'm happy to be here, and I'm looking forward to hearing what the rest of the panelists have to say.
Thank you, Jose. One thing about Chile at the Bancroft is that they have many of the mid 19th century periodicals or newspapers produced by Chileans in California, which connect. I mean, Bancroft, I don't think thought of Chile as part of the history of California, but it was. And the lynching of Hispanics beginning with Chilean miners, which right. is also forgotten by Mexican American studies. Right. But that is neither here nor there. But the problem of the categories and regions, what we privilege to collect and how we define the history of California, et cetera, as Mexican or Mexican American, when it might be more complex. In any event, Thank you. And now, Daniela.
Thank you, Jorge. And you know, you just said that's neither here nor there, but I think it's very, very important what you just said and very much follows on what both Melissa and Jose were talking about and what we can do today. Thank you so much for the invitation. This is such a great series of questions you have posed and such a privilege to be discussing them with the people here and with representatives of two of the great collections in the US. Some of the things that are very important for my thinking about this were already mentioned, which is that the moment of collecting creates specific concrete archives that have boundaries and set boundaries on what questions can be posed to those archives and what can be done with those questions. And so, 1921 is an important date, not only for the Bancroft, but in Mexico, and the timing in which these collections were first put together responds to certain interests that were interests of the Mexican collectors or the US collectors who were putting them together. So like any collection, it is shaped by the individuals, the things that they get their hands on, the interests that they have, and then we live with those legacies. And as both Melissa and Jose mentioned, if the collecting is always in the present, but the colonial archive that these collections have, which is where so much of the research by graduate students in the US is being done, then we really have to, you know, think what can be done with these collections, what stories are not there, and what stories, as you were just saying, are there but haven't been sort of so central, even if the materials are there, because the questions that are being posed are based on different geographies and different periodicities that obscure certain things. This is, of course, true of any collection, but it's something that has been really much in my mind for my own research in, you know, sort of an earlier period and with collections that are not in the Americas mostly, because the objects were taken and were taken overwhelmingly to Europe. Neil, where you are, the BNF has the, you know, one of the strongest collections of 16th century indigenous manuscripts in the world. And it was taken not, you know, not far from this moment of collecting. So what ends up where ends up having an incredible impact, but also what categories were being used to collect. And one of the questions that you pose, Jorge, is the divisions that have been created as to how objects are categorized and where they end up. So the fact that codices are seen as overwhelmingly library materials rather than museum materials, as books rather than as paintings, means that they end up in certain places and they get compared to other objects in those collections rather than in objects that are in other kinds of collection. So for me, one of the important things is the relationship between libraries, archives, and other kinds of collections, archaeological collections, visual and material culture collections, and how those can connect. I do hope that we get to talk, even though it's quite far from what I do, about the I don't know, arranged marriage of Latin American and Latinx as categories of study in the US. They are not, you know, they don't have that kind of domestic arrangement in other places. And I understand why they do here, but again, they end up creating certain connections that are hard to mine very deeply and obscuring others. It's, you know, I think the last time that Jorge and Neil and I were in the same room together was quite a few years ago, and it was in the context of planning meeting for an exhibition that I curated that was part of this huge Getty Foundation initiative, Pacific Standard Time, Los Angeles, Latin America, PST LALA, that was held in 2017. And of course, when we started planning in, you know, the golden years of after the 2012 election, we had no idea that when this was opening in 2017, it would be in the political climate than it did. But there were over, I think there were, oh, I forget the exact number, but over 80 exhibitions of Latin American and Latinx art in Southern California at the time. And I think there were three that touched on any period before the 20th century. And there were enormous tensions, sometimes productive and sometimes unproductive, about the emphasis on Latin America versus Latinx, which in some, for some projects, it worked beautifully. And for some projects, it actually put two things in conflict that wasn't resolved, where there were sort of opposing visions and opposing sides, and this idea that it's an either or. So the tensions were incredibly interesting. And I think that it's important to think about what will happen going forward, and what the collections permit. So I'll stop, but I'm really looking forward to our conversation.
This is fascinating. There's an anecdote about the Benson that is not sufficiently known, which is that one of the first individuals who was given the charge of organizing Genaro Garcia collection, Carlos Castañeda, who was from Nuevo León, I think, and wound up in Austin as an orphan, well, in the border, and then moved to Austin to study history. he was one of the founders of something called LULAC, the League of Latin American United Citizens. I mean, I don't remember exactly the translation, but it's the idea of the first definition of Latino, or among Mexicans in Texas, that we now call Latinos, were defined as Mexicans, not Mexican Americans, until 1956, was Latin American. And the definition of Latin America within this population was central in the in the way they fought integration of Mexicanos or Mexicans into the fold of the United States, the rights of Mexicans as Mexican Americans. And they triumphed in 1956 in the Supreme Court decision of Hernandez v. Texas. And central to the thinking of what was a citizen was the history of Latin American citizen, the battles of the 19th century over citizenship. This is very little known. So the boundaries between Latinos and Latin Americans, I think the Benson is the first experiment of how it challenges these boundaries we have in mind, because Carlos Castañeda and LULAC, all in by the way, in UT Austin, and so to the Hernandez v. Texas, challenged in a way all these boundaries we have created, Latino, Latin American, et cetera. I now allow Daniel to speak about the issues of Afro-Latino collecting.
Well, thank you very much, Jorge, for the invitation to be here, the Institute and Courtney. Yeah, as I am on, a different path or area as you guys. I'm not a librarian. I am a historian, and I work mainly in the digital humanities, or what became known as the digital humanities. So my observations about collecting, you know, they have to do more with, you know, collecting data and databases, more specifically data and databases that we integrate into the project that I host here at Rice University, the Slave Voyages website. Right? And our process was, just listening, you speaking and Jose in particular, in terms of acquisition of data, or it's very different. My practice or my experience has been more of approaching or leaving researchers who have collected themselves data and built databases, especially databases of voyages of ships they carried and intended to carry enslaved people from Africa to the Americas, and now also between points within the Americas, right? And integrate to our website. And we do this in different ways, right? We don't purchase them. What we do, we organize projects, we try to fund our projects and work in collaboration with researchers who are knowledgeable about archives and libraries that might contain this information and are willing to compile this data and build a database that will then be subsequently added to our website. So that's our primary means. We also accept contributions, voluntary contributions by the public, the general public, people who are interested on our research and our website. So we built a form or a portal on our website that allows the public to contribute whatever information they have about voyages that we currently have on our website or about new voyages altogether, right? Another way that we acquire data in databases is by donation. So researchers who have already done this work and they simply don't have where to store it, right? We accept donations so they can donate their databases, and then we add it to integrate to our website. So these are the means that we've found in order to acquire data and expand our collection, which is in itself made out of smaller collections. In terms of Latino, Latinx contributions, we had the first collections focusing on areas dominated by the Iberian Peninsula, and later on the countries that after independence continued participating in the slave trade. I think came from Herbert Klein. He had published a work on the slave trade to the Americas, and he had already compiled databases on the slave trade to Cuba and to Brazil, more specifically Rio de Janeiro. So, and later on he donated those to us, as well as to other libraries, as far as I know. And then starting around 1999, after the database was first published as a CD-ROM, it was more of a concerted effort to try to involve researchers, Latino and Latin American researchers in the project, and having them either collaborate through grants or donating their data to the website. So we had, for example, the database compiled by Professor Manolo Florentino in Rio de Janeiro added to our database. Right. There was also another researcher in Brazil, Corsino Medeiro dos Santos, published his database, and then we were able to integrate his database into our website. There was another contribution that we had. We have a younger generation of researchers who are now tenured professors who have also contributed. So, for example, Professor Roquinaldo Ferreira, right, also participate in the project, contribute data. Right? He actually spent about a year in archives in Lisbon compiling information. He's originally from Brazil. He's a Black researcher from Brazil, but he participated in the project and contributed data as well. Mariana Cândido is another one. Myself also participated in it. And we also have now a new crop, a new generation now emerging and being training, and who we hope in the future you'll collaborate with us as well.
Thank you, Daniel. But it's very telling that it's been the shift in the original database, right? From British Atlantic perspective to a more Luso-Hispanic perspective, not only in terms of the emphasis on Angola, Congo, Luanda, Benguela, yes. Rio, and Pernambuco, but also this emphasis on inter-American trade,
yes.
Right? That is no longer the Atlantic, but it's also...
No longer the Atlantic. This is a brand new addition and orientation of our website, right? The idea of having it dates back to around 2009, but thanks to a contribution by Greg O'Malley on the British slave trade in the Caribbean, we were able to create a page on the website and the system, right, to accommodate this data. And we have now expanded to include the slave trade between Brazil and Rio de la Plata, right, between the Spanish colonies in the Caribbean, and gradually more so because of a new funding that we managed to obtain from the National Endowment for the Humanities to connect voyages linking British Caribbean islands to Spanish Caribbean islands, Spanish Central American mainland, also on the Pacific coast, right? To Peru and Central America to Peru. And we also have a few voyages connecting California to regions in South America, including Brazil. So this is a very recent development. Latino, mainly Latin American researchers have been deeply involved. Professor Alex Barucci, for example, has been a lead in this project, and we're looking to grow. We really just started. It is even hard to estimate by the size of this traffic, but we know that it was somewhat lower than the transatlantic in terms of number of people moved, transported, but it was significantly higher in terms of numbers of voyages, right? Right now, if you go there on the Inter-American Slave Trade Database, we have something in the neighborhood of 25,000 records of voyages. Whereas, if you look at the transatlantic, which is fairly complete, we think at least, there are 36,000 records of voyages, right? So we expect that the Inter-American Slave Trade Database will be, in terms of numbers of voyages, much larger than the transatlantic one.
Thank you. Well, this is very telling. It's not just the fact that there's more data, it's also the shifting of the politics of collecting,
yes,
from an Anglo-American to a more hemispheric, yes, a more Spanish, Portuguese, Luso, Atlantic world as well, and more connected world. And in a sense, it's also an opportunity to rethink the history of slavery and Afro-American experience from a more hemispheric perspective, not so national, yes, as has been the case in the United States. But I'd like to invite now Neil to share with us his views as kind of the former director of one of the greatest libraries of Americana in the world, the John Carter Brown Library. Neil.
Thank you, Jorge. Great to be with all of you today. This is a fantastic panel with a lot of wonderful and interconnecting perspectives, and I'm it's a pleasure to be here. And I hope I echo some of the things that everybody have already said, because I think that what Melissa commented on related to access and who gets access is extremely important. What Jose was talking about, digitization, which is critical and very much of our moment. Daniela talking about the the kind of artificial distinctions between museums and libraries and archives, but also the artificial, potentially artificial distinction between Latinx and Latin Americans, super, super critical. And finally, the turn toward the digital humanities and the move toward a more global and interconnected set of resources. All of these things are really important. And I think it's actually a good, Danielle's comment reflect, it's a good moment to talk about what the JCB did and is doing. And as former director of that institution, you know, I spent a lot of time thinking about the history of the collection. And of course, what I think is distinctive about the JCB's collection is that it began very much as a hemispheric collection, seeking not to privilege the U.S. colonial experience over the Brazilian or the Chilean or the Mexican experience, even though at different times the collection grew in expansive ways. For instance, in terms of the Mexican collection, despite the fact that there is a relationship, potentially anyway, between the year of the library's founding, 1846, and the Invasión Norteamericana, otherwise known as the Mexican-American War, most of the prized Mexican material really didn't come into the collection until the late 19th century. At the behest of the then librarian, George Parker Winship, who was not born until 25 years after the collection actually got its start. So I think also, you know, and this was certainly something that all of the panelists have mentioned thus far, we have to be very careful about how we characterize these collections, because they grow at particular moments, the priorities shift and change. And also there are relationships that I would say historians are not always fully, or scholars are not fully aware, because they haven't lived within these organizations. And I feel very privileged, you know, as a scholar, but having had the opportunity to work within the library and to see the relationship between book dealers, collectors, and librarians and curators, which are very much fundamental in mostly good ways, but often negative ways as well, in terms of what the collections end up being. So I think we have to really delve down deeply into why collections are the way that they are, and how we as historians or scholars make use of those collections. The collection, I spent a lot of time, Jorge, thinking about your question regarding, what collections, what the current moment, the Black Lives Matter movement, and this renewed attention to the presence of African and African descended people within these collections vis-a-vis Latin American collections. And obviously I thought mostly through the JCB, but even in our conversation, I thought, you know, nobody is going to make the argument that Latin America or Latin Americans are underrepresented within US-based collections. In fact, I think, we have extraordinarily strong collections, often because the whole definition of Americana included those categories from the get-go. That is not nearly as true for African collections. Even though when I did work at the JCB, I very much, in fact, I was sort of paid to, but I very much defended John Carter Brown's collecting, in that he and those who followed him never, at least consciously, excluded anything related to Africa or the slave trade and slavery. And I often used to say that they collected the good, the bad, and the ugly. And because of the expansive nature of the collection, I can't necessarily say that is true about the Huntington. In fact, I think that's an interesting comparative case. JCB never shied away from collecting materials in other languages. It seems to me that Huntington was much more focused on the Anglo-American world at the outset. Obviously, that has changed today. Daniela, you've spent a lot more time in the collection than I have. I'd be curious to sort of talk about, you know, different pockets of the collection and such. But I do think that, you know, from 1846 onward, there was material related to the slave trade in the JCB. It really depends on how it is that we use those materials, how we read them, how we now create digital resources and digital platforms to work across them and interconnect them. I'm currently working on a project that relates to the presence, at least in part, the presence of enslaved peoples of African descent in the so-called scientific literatures of late 18th and early 19th century Brazil. This is material, Daniel, like the Fazendeiro do Brasil, the Arco do Cego. These are translations often of plantation manuals from the French and the British Caribbean that then are meant to be used by plantation owners in the Brazilian context. In order to understand the presence of enslaved peoples, we have to understand how those materials were translated from one idiom, from one kind of ideological stage to the next. That is very much on us as scholars, but in tandem with librarians and curators, because we need to work, they need to understand the way in which we are seeking to use this material, and we need to understand how collections were formed in the first place so that we can assist in bringing those two angles together. I think the Enslaved Project is a perfect example of that. And I'm more optimistic, I think, than anything else. I just wanted to, in closing, mention a couple of projects that I think are really operating on the right track. One is the Black Bibliography Project out of Yale and Rutgers, which is seeking to create a kind of a digital archive of materials from the late 18th century into the 19th and 20th century. The other project by Rachel Stein of Tulane University Libraries, the Afro-Central American Library Guide, where I think Rachel is really kind of taking a pioneering look at how these materials can come together. And I think that project will benefit from scholars, you know, in conversation and dialogue with her and other librarians about what is useful to them. So I look forward also to the rest of the conversation.
Well, thanks, Neil. I think Daniela has to leave us. She has another business to attend, and we really appreciate that you made the time to be with us. Well, we have a question already, and I think it's a very provocative one, and I think we should begin with that one, perhaps. Our conversation is by Miruna Achim. We'll be discussing her edited collection tomorrow on also a webinar on collecting and museums in Mexico in the 19th century in particular. And her question is very, very, a very timely one, given the recent announcement by the Smithsonian on the Benin bronzes and return of those bronzes to Benin. And she says, in the past decades, objects in museums and collections, which have often arrived there through asymmetrical power relations, have been at the center of demands for repatriation. How have archives in the United States and Europe been preparing to face and answer similar challenges? Daniela mentioned the Bibliothèque Nationale de France collection of Mexican manuscripts, which we know were smuggled out of Mexico in the 1840s. But the Bibliothèque Nationale de France is not the only case, of course. We should add the Benson as well to that group, and of also the bankrupt and John Carter Brown, Hispanic Society, and every other collection of Latin Americana in the United States and Europe. So I don't know whether anyone to tackle that one, Neil.
Jorge, I don't want to respond to that, but I think Javier Ramirez Lopez is asking a question that I think is very directly related to that. So perhaps if you want to read that one as well, and then we can maybe respond to both together.
Okay. Yes. I just saw it. I was focused on Miruna's question, but yes, interesting presentations. Congratulations. For the last few years, I've been researching the Mexican documentary exodus in the 19th century. I've had the opportunity to go to the Benson Bankrupt and John Carter Brown libraries. In this context, I would like to know if there is any strategy to stop the contemporary looting of Mexican archives, and in the case of acquiring a stolen piece, could we seek its return? The looting, it's just as even worse now than it was in the 19th century. Thank you. Anyone wants to tackle that one? What to do with the origins of the Benson around the Genaro Garcia collection? I personally don't know very much about the origins of Genaro Garcia's 200,000 pages of manuscripts. He has a lot of codices that I studied myself, Osuna and others. Well, not Osuna, excuse me, others, but that are extraordinary documents of litigation, indigenous litigation in the 1500s. But he has many other, it's a vast array of documents from all periods, and all origins. And I really don't know whether there has been a study of how he acquired all these massive documentary collection, and whether it's connected to the reform in Mexico, the secularization of politics, and the pillaging of religious archives that eventually many of them wound up in the United States.
Since the Benson is sort of the centralized entity that ties this panel together, and it's centennial, I'm certainly willing to take this on to somewhat, and would love to hear the thoughts of others on the panel. I think those are absolutely valid and important questions, and I think the answers are complex. Sometimes they're easy, sometimes it's straightforward, and I think anytime you could show a direct link of a smuggling of materials, of stolen documents, and that there's a case to be made for repatriation, it's a conversation to have. And what we tend to say is, it's not a conversation that we would shy away from at all. I think the history of the Benson is more complicated. And as you spoke to, Jorge, a lot of the question is and I'm talking specifically about the two largest foundational collections, Garcia and Icazbalceta, 1921 and 1937, respectively, that they were intact collections put together by Mexican historian bibliophiles. In Garcia's case, he also was a public figure, a politician. These folks were not unknown, right? Within Mexican circles, it was not unknown that they were amassing these materials. In Garcia's case, the more I read about him, the more, the difference between Garcia and Icazbalceta is Icazbalceta lived longer and actually could use the materials that he collected for his own purposes. Garcia had the same idea in mind, but didn't live long enough. And Icazbalceta actually, at least the documentation that we have within the Benson is that he corresponded with US historians quite a bit, is particularly Prescott, William Prescott, and folks who were working on what we would now call the borderlands, or the parts of the US that were once part of New Spain, et cetera. And so those connections, I guess it's interesting to note that those connections were there at the time with Garcia and Icazbalceta, that they had connections with scholars in the US. We know less about how Garcia acquired his materials than we do Icazbalceta. We know and we can trace somewhat, because Icazbalceta is the primary collection that had the Relaciones Geográficas, right? And we have, I think, 42 or 43 of them, and a big majority of them include the pinturas, the mostly indigenous drawn maps. And the majority of those actually were removed from Spain at some point. You know, they were created, sent to the sent back to the peninsula, and then at some point he acquired them through private channels. So the hard part is, where do you, how long do you follow the trail? And then what do you do with the information you have about the trail? And that's not to, it's not to say that an institution like the Benson or the JCB doesn't have a role to play in these conversations and in these actions of acknowledging national patrimony. I will also say that in current practice, we can just say up front that if a collection like the Garcia collection were to become available, there's no way we would acquire that in this day and age. And quite frankly, I don't think the JCB would either. And I don't think the Bancroft would either. I don't want to speak for those institutions, but I think it would be a tough conversation to have, right? And so I can tell you that, and I assume this is also the case of the other major institutions across the US, that the number of offers we receive, I think people would be surprised. And the number of times we say no. And the number of times we say no is not necessarily a function of the budgets we have, right? Because quite frankly, a lot of the Benson collection is built through donations, particularly our Latinx holdings and our Black diaspora holdings. A lot of those are through donations of the actual creators of those materials, right? Not exclusively, but a lot. And more often than not, if we are confronted with something that would resemble, or else, or someone might reach out to us and say, well, we think that this would fill in some nice gaps in the Garcia collection, for example. Now I'm giving you sort of the in the weeds process of how these things work. We say that isn't our focus anymore, and you should reach out to the Museo Nacional de Antropología, right? Or we know this institution in Mexico might be interested in acquiring that material. So it's not to say that we don't acquire any colonial material anymore. We actually just got some materials related to the slave trade in Colombia, for example, for our Black Diaspora Archive. It's just that we don't seek to recreate the process that brought the Garcia project and the Garcia collection to the United States and to the Benson. And we could have another conversation that talks specifically about how that collection was brokered, because it was brokered. It was a financial transaction between the family of Genaro Garcia and the University of Texas, and quite frankly, the state government of Texas. But we just don't operate on that same level. And I don't want to speak for the other institutions, but I don't think we're alone in that way.
No, absolutely not. And just as a, you know, Genaro Garcia, we have letters of it being offered to Bancroft, to the Bancroft Library at that point, before it was offered to UT Austin. So you're absolutely right. And I think, yeah, we do have to sort of think of how these, we ask these questions, because, you know, we know for the first three collections that Bancroft acquired for Mexico, they were all via auction in European cities that were taken out of Mexico by the Mexican owners who had collected them from the reform, the issues that were happening during the reform, really, really targeted convent libraries. And Mexicans themselves were the ones who gathered that material and then had it in their homes and then offered it for sale. Yes, I think we could certainly look at it in our 21st century eyes of you know, smuggling and these sorts of things. But I think we need to think about the 19th century context of these collections and how they were taken out of Mexico by Mexicans and sold at auction. The issue, as Melissa pointed, rightfully, we do require that any offer, even just the offer itself, have provenance, that we are shown where these documents come from. And if it, and absolutely right, if there is any sense that something is not legitimately acquired or has been in a family holdings for, you know, a long period of time, then we will gladly decline it. And yes, I think acquiring anything like those early collections would just be impossible today. I have to keep telling the same person, I'm sorry, but no, I can't do this. And it's the same person who writes me back and says, but what if, and I just keep saying, no, these are the institutions in Mexico that you should contact.
And I do want to add that I think that if we're, the situation, at least with the Benson's early collections, and the response in Mexico about the acquisitions, the response to the Garcia acquisition and the Icazbalceta were different. And I think you can point to the realities of the Mexican situation at the time. We have documentation. It's not that folks in Mexico watched this happen without saying anything. Right. And so we have documentation of folks publishing in local periodicals. And these are scholars who had relationships in the United States, and they knew that the Icazbalceta collection had left Mexico and gone to the US, and they were angry, and rightly so. They were angry mostly what they expressed was anger at the Mexican government for not stepping in, anger at the Mexican government for allowing the collections to leave. I don't have specific documentation for Icazbalceta, but we do know that the Garcia collection was offered, at least anecdotally, through the records we have, that it was offered to the Mexican government and they turned it down. And it's not to say that nobody in the Mexican government cared about those collections. I think they had a lot on their hands in 1921. And that wasn't necessarily front of mind in terms of financial priorities. But by 1937, there were certainly enough people within Mexico to clamor to say, like, hey, look what's happening. This stuff is leaving and you're not doing anything. And there wasn't much done at the time. Now, what I don't want to do is dismiss the questions that were asked about what about modern day smuggling and modern day movement of cultural patrimony. Absolutely. And we don't exist outside that space. What we can do is do our best to investigate provenance and then respond accordingly. That is our response. And I think there is a difference between smuggling materials out of an archive and then selling them on the open market and brokering an acquisition, a mutually agreed upon acquisition with a long-time owner or family member of a particular collection for its safeguarding and scholarly use. And the hard thing for us and for scholars is that sometimes those forces or those, quite frankly, those commercial markets sometimes intersect. And that's where we have to be very careful.
Go ahead.
No, just a couple of things about this conversation. One is the interesting fact that one of the greatest bibliographers, collectors in Latin America, Medina, was this Icazbalceta of Chile and South America. It's a counterexample of these tendencies in that his collection was purchased by the Chilean state. And remains in Chile to this day, and is one of probably the greatest collections of printed materials, colonial printed materials. There is particularly of South America. There is no comparison. It has more materials in many respects than the JCB or I don't know the. In some aspects,
I was actually going to mention the Medina collection, Jorge. Not to interrupt you, but I was first of all going to say that one of the things that exists today is an amazing network of collaborative colleagues on both sides of many borders. And I was very much, you know, I think, you know, and Jose and Melissa and many others part, you know, form a part of that network. And there's a tremendous amount of collaboration around ascertaining whether or not materials were acquired, you know, appropriately, whether which repository they deserve to be in, where they can make the best, you know, make the best use. Because a lot of these materials, it's not as if there is a, you know, one repository that makes the most sense all the time. It's a very complicated situation. There are, you know, there is looting on every side of every border. What I will say about the Medina collection, this was a really difficult, you know, you probably know this, Jorge, that the Medina collection, Medina himself offered his collection to the JCB in 1912, if I'm not mistaken, for approximately, I think about, it was about $250,000, which would have been about five times the annual acquisitions budget for the JCB. And the lawyers at the time for Brown University basically made the determination that they couldn't reach that far forward, and so the collection or the purchase did not happen. Now I had the pleasure and privilege of going to visit the collection, and as then director of the JCB, it broke my heart a little bit, because I think that one of the positive things that one can say about the most of the collections in the U.S. is that, and this returns to Jose's comment, is that there is a dedication and a commitment to digitizing them and making them accessible and available to anybody who desires to use them. And that, I think we will wait longer than our lifetimes to see the Medina collection digitized and made available for the use of the world. And I think, you know, and that's just the reality of the, you know, the Chilean government does not, and the Chilean National Library does not have the money to dedicate to digitizing materials related to the history of Peru, and or the history of Colombia, or the history of Brazil, or the history of Mexico. They're not going to do that unless they receive some sort of major influx. So, you know, this is where my own, you know, feeling is, especially now, you know, as a scholar, having access to all of the material that that the JCB and other libraries, the Bibliothèque Nationale de France, have digitized, it's really phenomenal. And I think that I personally would rather see material in archives that are going to make them accessible to the world, rather than necessarily having them located in places where they were originally collected. Because of course, you know, the Medina was collecting them, was bringing them in from all over the place, including Peru, you know, illegally. So, you know, again, that's my own personal kind of tendency. And I think that should be discussed. And I'm sure there will be people who vehemently disagree. But I think it's really important in today's digital age to think about where are these materials most likely to be permanently made into an accessible repository. I would like to see materials go in that direction rather than necessarily return to whatever their putative home might be determined to be.
Thank you. Yeah, well, I spent a couple of weeks in Santiago working in the Medina collection not through the actual thing, but through microfilm. So you don't get to actually see the object, you get to see the microfilm. In any event, one of the things that both Melissa and Jose brought up is I think Melissa, this Icazbalceta collection that he collected in Spain. And so the Relaciones Geográficas were in Spanish archives and he collected. And I think this is part of also traditional collecting in Latin America, that in the 19th century and early 20th century, of very wealthy men who wound up in Spain and did in Spain what we are claiming the U.S. collectors did with Latin American collections. I'm thinking of Jacinto José Camaño in Ecuador, who was a very wealthy hacendado landowner who spent decades traveling through archives in Spain and collected all sorts of materials and brought them back to Ecuador, some kind of the opposite neocolonialism when it comes to collection. and gathering materials from Spain. And there was this tendency, I think, in Latin American countries in the first half of the 19th century of sending scholars, financing them, sending them to archives, and bringing stuff back. I think Venezuela has, I don't know, volumes and volumes of materials, transcriptions from the archive of the Indies, not the actual stuff, but copies. And one wonders about that. It's very little known, but could perhaps somebody work on a dissertation on it. In any event, so the question is now, where are we heading? Not so much the past, but the future. I think Melissa is giving us some clues as to what the priorities of the Benson are, that it's more contemporary stuff, not so much the acquisition of actual collections. The digitization of things that we have, but also something that the Benson has been working on, which is these the digitization of archives somewhere else that are made accessible through the resources of the Benson. I don't know whether the bankrupt has some is going in that direction. Certainly, the efforts of the slave archive go definitely in that direction, and the JCV as well. So I don't know whether you want to tackle this question.
Yeah, maybe I can contribute something here because. One of our, well, we just now received the NEH award to develop an infrastructure on our website that will allow us now to store images of historical documents on our servers, donated by institutions there and or researchers that would like to do that. So I'm already anticipating and learning a lot from you guys on how to address donations. But also that will permit us now to link our voyages, you know, to images of documents located at their original repositories. Mm-hmm. So, and that's actually our preferred route, right? Because, you know, maintaining images on our servers is, you know, very expensive. So we prefer actually to partner with institutions and work with them so they can digitize their material and make them or part of them available on our website through permanent links, right? So right now, as a pilot, we're gonna try to have the Huntington, the Clements Library, and the Library and the British Library to digitize their collections of the related to the South Sea Company. And it's a British company that served slaves across the Atlantic and in the Caribbean. You know, British Caribbean, but also Spanish Caribbean, and connect, you know, the voyages that we have on our database, you know, to the images, to these documents, you know, and their original repository through permanent links.
I think, Daniel, I think what you describe is exactly the wave of the future. It's the now, and it's the wave of the future, and I think you've touched on a couple of things in your previous comments about what institutions like the Benson and the JCB, and I don't know as much about the Bancroft, Jose, but are trying to do, where when you go about doing that kind of linkages, right? Like, it becomes a more collaborative effort. An example that where at least the technical side lives at UT is the Primeros Libros, but of course the biggest collection of the Primeros Libros in the United States is at JCB. That is where there is a tremendous value to scholars. It's the collecting for the purposes of making the materials available regardless of where they live. And the other advantage of that, and this is something that you also talked about, Daniel, is that it's not necessarily restricted to scholars. That this is something that it's almost like you can crowdsource this stuff, and that you're willing to bring people into the conversation that normally wouldn't exist in this space. And there's a real democratizing piece to that. Of course, the access to technology isn't always equally distributed, but there is a real ability for a more to put folks on a more equal footing. And then I think the last thing I will say is something that, you touched on, Neil, when you talk about the JCB as a hemispheric collection. One of the things that we're working on at the Benson is our Black Diaspora Archive. It's a relatively new initiative at UT, and it was purposely defined by the faculty who pushed this effort as a hemispheric collection. And I think it's intentional and it's good, but I think it also presents major challenges because you can't collect everything and you have to figure out what your parameters are within certain budgets, right? If I had an unlimited budget, imagine what I could do. I mean, all of us can nod our heads to that. Imagine what we could do with unlimited budgets. But deciding what it means to have a hemispheric Black diaspora archive at the Benson it's a real opportunity and a challenge. And so I guess I would say to the audience and to everyone else on this panel, like, watch this space, let's see what we do with it. And right now, given how it was started and in the connections that were made, it's actually much more rooted in the United States than it is Latin America. And that is starting to shift as we get Latin American scholars more interested in the process. It now seems to be taking a tack where the emphasis is going to be on Afro-Latin American and Afro-Latinx cultural production and intellectual contribution rather than just documentation. So Afro-Latin American scholars themselves and their output and documenting that. But it's one of those things that mirrors exactly what you were talking about, Neil, where in the 19th century, a decision was made to create a hemispheric collection. But over time, the individuals who then shape that collection move it in certain directions that may or may not have been the original intention, which is somewhat irrelevant. But the point is, we have to all be aware of the role that we play. And then going forward, trying to be as inclusive as possible as we go about deciding what those priorities will be. And not only inclusive, but to try and be as transparent as possible, knowing that we will make mistakes along the way and that we won't be able to include everything that someone would want us to include. And with that, I'll stop talking and listen to somebody else for a minute.
Neil, any insights, or Jose?
I was just going to say that, I'm recalling now just the sense of tremendous possibility, but also extreme frustration that being within a library represents today. Because the tools that we have at our fingertips now and the tools that will be developed over the course of the next 10 to 20 years will utterly transform every kind of project that we are able to do. And I think we're at a complicated moment because we don't quite yet have the platform that I can certainly say, as a scholar, we would like to use. But I think also as a librarian that we would want to put material into. I know that at the JCB, we were in the process of developing a kind of a digital platform that would allow for annotation of documents and sharing of documents across platforms. A lot of institutions are in the process of doing precisely that. Some are competing with each other. Some are collaborating with one another. There's no way of kind of organizing the whole thing. The UT Austin Black Diaspora Project will be one among literally, I'm sure, hundreds that may or may not speak to one another. and that may or may not have to be rewritten in 5 or 10 years. So, you know, I think, obviously the slave, you know, voyages is again an example where there's a tremendous critical mass that has, you know, acquired enough momentum and had the original, you know, good idea at the outset, and now has institutional backing, that, you know, it would be surprising if someone were to try to replicate what, you know, you guys, Danielle, have already tried to do. The addition of materials to that, you know, some kind of what we might call ancillary or anecdotal or kind of, you know, different kinds of materials than the original database, that's a fascinating and super important project. There needs to be a way to do that that will allow people to contribute across multiple, you know, forms of interpretation, because the general public may in fact have a lot that they want to contribute to that, and scholars as well, and, you know, and people in different languages and from different traditions, you know, who may be turned off by the fact that this is primarily in English. I think it still is, although maybe you I'm sure you guys have thought through that as well. In any case, I mean, the technical problems and challenges are limitless. So are the possibilities, and you know, it's exciting, but also stressful to be participating in these conversations at this particular moment.
Yeah, I agree. One of the things that we recognize that we lag behind, at least for the Latin Americana collection, is we do need to digitize more, and I'm trying to sort of propose which materials, because we do have, you know, it. I wish it were just a very straightforward answer, like, oh, we'll just put these on a thing and digitize them, and then they're done, right? But that process is, at least for us, is there's a lot more that happens in the background. There's a lot more staff that's needed to make these things happen, and I think sometimes, you know, we have to stop and recognize that we also have a limited number of staff. You know, Melissa said if we had a number, if we had countless budgets, well, I would hire staff, because that's sometimes what we often need, is not necessarily the materials. It's the staff that also gets us to get that material ready for whatever other form it has to take. So I think that's also not an issue that certainly I'm sure it's not alone to Bancroft. I think this is certainly happened to any public institution in this country. It is certainly suffering from that. But I think, yeah, the digitizing or picking what gets digitized too is always a hard thing. What do you want to focus on? Where do we want to go with what materials do we want to highlight? And I think that those are really important questions that we have to keep asking. I, for one, Bancroft has one of the largest collections of Inquisition materials that are outside of Mexico. The most recent batch was acquired in the 1990s, and I would love to see these digitized and made available. And then not only that, but also in platforms that allow for transcription and possible translation of these documents, because it's making it, you know, if you just put it up, it's, you know, what do you do with that? Where does it go? Who's going to be able to read that? Not everyone has the skills to read, you know, procesal writing. So where do we go with these, what, you know, with the future projects? And you know, I'm happy to be part of the NEH sponsored UT Austin's library, the Benson Library's digital humanities thing that's happening right now. So I'm learning from Albert on all these different platforms that we can work to use these materials and make them not only more available but also usable. And I think that's where, you know, your project, Daniel, is so fascinating, because that's exactly where we would like to go, and I think a lot of us would like to go. And
well, this is, I mean, we're unfortunately running out of time, but I would like to bring up talking about colonial collections. Neil and Jose, but also Melissa, although that seems not to be the priority now of the Benson. But talking about digital initiatives at the Benson on first books, one of the concerning things about the issue of defining first books in Latin America is the way we define Latin America. And that is so patronizing and condescending and problematic, that we forget that the huge bulk of production of Latin America that is by Latin Americans in Latin American universities in the colonial period was not published in Mexico, was not published in Peru, was not published in the printing presses of colonial Latin America. They were printed in Lyon, they were printed in Cologne, they were printed in outside even the peninsula, Salamanca or Alcalá. And we're talking about dozens of these things, if not hundreds of them, major intellectual contributions to law, theology, biblical scholarship, et cetera, that were not published in Latin America. They were published in Europe. So what about that? The premises that organize our collecting and understanding of Latin America, what is Latin America? What are the first books? Needs to be contested, needs to be part of a conversation. I would, for one, say it is deeply problematic to assume that the first books of Latin America were simply printed in Mexico. Where they were not. They were produced outside Mexico in Salamanca, Alcalá, France, etc. And they need to be included in these initiatives. We're talking about 1500s. We're not talking about 1600s. And there are dozens of them, beginning with Rubio's publications in France, et cetera. This is one of the scholars of founders of the Mexican University.
Yeah.
Anybody cares to engage with this?
Yeah.
I mean, I was just going to say that, you know, I think one has to think about the, you know, the value. I mean, obviously, Primeros Libros is a, you know, I don't know who dreamed it up, but it's the imagined category that, you know, makes sense today to valorize something that happened 100 years before it happened in North America, which is hugely valorized. So I think that, you know, that's one of the arguments to make. The only, you know, thing that I would say, Jorge, about your idea is that maybe that's going to water down a category that's actually working quite effectively to demonstrate that there was something going on south of the border of the United States before it was happening north of the border. But you know, to be discussed. I think, you know, this brings me to, you know, one of the things I was going to mention after what Jose said, which is that we also need to be very conscious of how we speak and how we advocate for what it is that libraries and archives are doing. And that's advocacy work that's not only to the NEH or to the Mellon Foundation, but also to wealthy Americans, wealthy Latin Americans, wealthy Latinx individuals who can very, very easily finance a huge amount of the kind of work that needs to be done now. So we, you know, I think as, you know, as scholars, as librarians, as curators and archivists, we need to think about what is it that we can, how can we portray what it is that we're doing in a way that will get support from a much larger public? Because that's ultimately what we want to do, is to build bridges. And it's a hard thing to think about, but I think it's a really valuable thing to do, because as one collector in the Bay Area once said to me, he said, you know, today we're building the digital collection like in the 19th century the great libraries in the US were building their physical collections. That is the way we have to sell it to wealthy individuals. We have to, you know, in a sense, market what we're doing as a value to humanity. And if we can do that, then that's going to allow us to build an Afro-Americana collection digitally that will support the slave trade, will allow us to do collections, Latino collections, across the board from California to Texas and beyond. I think, you know, that's really kind of the direction that we need to, again, as libraries have always been thinking, not building the physical collection so much, building the digital collection that will allow universal access.
Well, it's 1:30. Thank you everyone for being here, for participating, for engaging in this conversation and these questions. There's a lot of more conversations to have, but in the meantime, thank you very much. These will be available online in the coming week. And so hopefully there will be a wider audience to this important conversation that we just had. Thank you again. Thank you, Courtney. Thank you, Ashley. Thank you, each one of you.
Thank you.
And the audience as well.
It's great
and
to see
tomorrow,
you.
Tomorrow, Central Time.
Thank you, Jorge.
Thank
Gracias.
You, Jorge.
Hasta luego.
Ciao.
Adios.